in your house, Father. Lord, we just thank you for the joy, your presence, as we come to worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, we thank you for the privilege of being in your house. Lord, we thank you for the power of the word and the power of your song, Lord. You will be glorified in this place because there is no other name than the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So, Lord, have your way in this place. Lord, we thank you, rejoice in you. And everyone said, amen. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
in birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church.
Church this morning. Amen.
Lifted on high, calling us home with us.
come to me with your praise and worship. Lose yourself in my presence. As you come into my presence, open your hearts and minds. Let me come in. I will never force my way into you because I love you. I want to do a work in each one of you, a work of love, healing of body and mind, to strengthen you, to give you a peace that the world can't give you. Just come into my presence and let me do what is needed in your life. My children, because my love is so great for you.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
And all we need is you. And all we need is you. And all we need is you. Worthy is the Lamb. seated on the throne. Crown him now with many crowns. You reign victorious. I am lifted up, Jesus, Son of God, the darling of heaven, crucified. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Thank you.
of God. It seemed empty. God said, come in, people. There is room for everyone. I have crowns to be handed out. I have crowns with your names on it. Wear them with pride. My son paid for them all.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Do something to you, church. His name is higher, greater. He's going to do something to you on the inside. It's just lifts you. Lifts you, lifts you, lifts you. Holy One. Holy God. Holy Master. Holy Savior. What would you have, Lord? Thank you, Jesus. aim is high. And what I want you to do is something for me. All I had in my heart was when doing this. It's like an abandonment. I abandoned myself to Him. So what the Word of God gets come out is about He is worthy of everything, team. He is worth everything. Worthy of everything. And church, as we come to Him, as you come to Him now, this morning, let's go, our Lord, Your name is higher. And because there is higher, Your Word is greater. My hope has to be in Him. It cannot be in man. It cannot be in your bank account. It cannot be in anything. It's got to be in Jesus. And so as we sing that, understand that His name is above every name that's on the earth, under the earth, wherever you want to be, whatever you may be facing. His name is higher. His name is greater. His name is worthy to be praised. And so as we do that, abandon yourself to Him. Just say, yeah, Lord, I've got no other hope, but it's in You. No other hope. The doctors say there's no hope. The bankers say there's no hope. Our friends say there's no hope. Our families say there's no hope. But you know there's what? We are not hopeless. We have hope filled. We have hope in Jesus. And as you do that this morning, abandon yourself to Him. Let Him carry your burden this morning. Come on now, church. Faith, hope, love. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. The word hope there is your blueprint for your faith, for your future. Hope in God is your blueprint for your future in Him. Come on. Now think about that. The Word of God, your master, your hope in Him, your hope in the Word, hope by His Spirit, is the blueprint for your future. If you do not have that blueprint for your future, where are you going? What map are you following? What drawing are you following as you build your life? I want to encourage you this morning. I'm going to say it one more time, but I want you to say, our hope is in Him. My blueprint is Him. My life is in Him. My future is Him. In Him. Everything that I have and will be and want to be is in who? It's in Him. Let's say it one more time, please. I need to turn around to someone this morning and say, good to be in the house of the Lord. But remember in whom your hope is. Remember who your hope is in. Remember who you hope in this morning. Go give her somebody a love. Get out of your seats. Go say hi to someone. Love on them. Love them. Especially if we got new, more visitors and things. Say hi, hi, hi. Hi, you. Say hi. Bless you. Good to have you all with us. Wonderful Jesus. Love, 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 love. Love, love. Everybody, lovey, 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 love. Loving everyone. God's so good. God good. Hallelujah. What? No. Hold on. Oh, yeah. Hallelujah. Haven't God good? I'm searching for those new people, and we have a lovely visitor who's going to be with us for a few weeks. Pastor Anna is here from, if anybody else is here, Pastor Anna, welcome. We'd love to have you with us from Singapore. And she's going to be teaching part of our Chinese family, and she's asked me to come and interpret from Mandarin for her. Of course, you all know I'm absolutely fluent. Fluent, amen. So, but love to have you. And you must have your dad with you this morning. Is that right? Yeah, it's your dad. Welcome, Dad. Nice to see you for the first time. Was someone giving that? Hallelujah. It's nice to have you a lot with us. Oh, and I can't miss you. You guys are going to help Steve Darby? Okay. Why don't you and your husband, or you and your family, who's going? Okay. Why don't you come down here? We're going to pray for you right now. Come, whoever's going to Thailand. You know, Steve Darby, just before, were you going to introduce him, Jim? Oh, sorry about that, man. Come. Where are you? Come down here. This couple has just come back from, as you know, our missionary, who's Steve Darby. Give kids hope. Stand there, guys. Wonderful. Look at them. They come visit with us because in a few weeks or... middle of February, they're going to go back. They've sold up everything and they're going back to Thailand. Let me have the pastors come. They're not, actually, first time I've met them. But if you're going to be with our family in Thailand, then we want to be with the where I'm pastor. We're there. My wife here. Stretch your hand out to them, church, because they're going, believing God to use them. And we want this same anointing that is on HFCC that flows through Steve to flow through them. Father, right now we lay our hands upon them. Commission them to your service in the mission field of Thailand, Lord. We thank you that you will use them. Lord, let that anointing that's on the inside of them flow. Let it be, Lord, that they'll make an impact in those children's lives. And Lord, they go to serve Steve and his wife and family. And because of their servant's heart, Father, we thank you for them. We thank you. We're going to see great miracles, Lord. So we bless you for them being with us. And we send them forth with our love, Lord, in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Lovely to have you with us. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is there anybody else who's not been? Dad's here. Our Sandra's got a son with us. See, you don't know. I know everyone. Hallelujah. Hello, Aggie. You ain't hiding in the back. You can't hide in the back, man. Hallelujah. Another family from South Africa. Welcome, a family from Brisbane. Wonderful. Haven't seen you since before Christmas. Welcome. Love him. It's wonderful when people come all the way from the other side of Brisbane to be with us and things. And so we love having you with us. And you as well. Love you. Yeah. Amen. Is he hiding in the back there? Hello. Welcome. Welcome. Hallelujah. Okay. What am I doing? Oh, and I've got to welcome you by live stream. And say thank you for being with us. And as you know, we go across the world, across the nation. We've got many, many people who we serve by live stream. And it's just such a wonderful, wonderful thing. So, where are we going next? We're going you.
Good morning, church. Just a quick reminder, next week, Professor David Block. Everyone say next week. No excuses to invite some friends. See the empty chairs? Fill them. That's our challenge, amen? I believe that will be blessed. Anybody that tries to figure God out with their head, get them in here. God will quickly unramble that, amen? So next week, please, he's an awesome motivational speaker. The other thing is the church offices are back open on Wednesday this week. Everyone say, woo! Pastor Diane is so excited. She says, please phone her. She would love to hear from you. Amen. And then her heritage. Everyone say the 12th of February. Not the 5th. 12th of February. Not the 5th. Her heritage starts. Amen. Who's up for the offering? Jim.
Make yourselves comfortable. If you have your Bibles with you, would you turn to Matthew 22, please? Matthew 22, I'm going to read from the King James. If you'd put slide one up for me, please. Jesus was asked, Master, which is the great commandment of the law? And Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. This is the first and the great commandment. And the second is like unto it, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. And you're probably wondering what this has got to do with tithes and offerings, and I'll tell you. Would you put slide two up, please? Just a few moments ago, we did number one. We entered his gates with thanksgivings and praise, and we were thankful and we blessed his name. The second, which Jesus said, love your neighbor as yourself, and that's where we come in. That's where you come in with your giving. It's not about how much you give, because God's looking at the inward. He's looking at the reason why you give. Would the ushers like to come forward and receive your gifts? This is an opportunity for you to give to people in need. Not just, I mean, I have a list of missionary organizations that we deal with locally, nationally, and overseas, but also to each other. Notice we're sitting in comfortable seats. We're in an auditorium that has sound, it has everything we need, and that's all come from your giving. Live stream is available through your giving. So right now, somebody on live stream, who knows where in the world or where in Australia they have been enjoying the praise and worship, and they're going to get fed the word of God all because of our giving. So it reaches out. It doesn't always have to be a Christian organization. So you took mine, I'm taking yours. It's just reaching out beyond yourself. And that can be to your neighbor, to whoever it might be. It's giving. And it's giving with a joyful heart. Would you like to bring those gifts forward? The Lord spoke to me a little while ago and he said, Jim, he said, if I could give you one complaint when you get to heaven, what would it be? And I said, Lord, it would be, why did you give me such a heart to give and so insufficiency in the ability of giving? He said, well, that's giving grudgingly. So cut that out of your vocabulary and just be thankful for what you have. It might be a dollar. It might be all you have is to reach forward and pray as we pray over this giving. So if you just stretch out your hands, and we're just going to bless this as we give it to God. Father, we just thank you in the name of Jesus for every dollar that has been given with joyful hearts. We know in your hands, Father, it becomes life, it becomes hope, and we do it with love. We thank you, Father God, for optimum yield harvest increase on everyone who's given. And we thank you for opening doors, Father God, for those who have not been able to give, Father, so that in the future they will have seed to sow. We give you all the glory, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah, thank you, team. Oh, why don't you just pray for a second? We need to pray for you. You're going away for 2 or 3 months. You are? 2 months? Come here, my blessing. Donald, I want to pray for you. Come. Church family, when one of our family people come, go away, we want to bless you, love you, because you're very precious and you're very bright.
Thank
He's very bright colors. Amen. Just stretch your hands and agree with me. Father, thank you for every need to be met. That, Lord, you'll open doors that you desire for her. Let your gifts operate. And let your peace be hers right now. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Go with anointing. Go with blessing. Thank you for it. Thank you for it, Lord. Amen, my darling. Peace. Peace, peace, peace. Amen. We do love you. God's good, isn't he? Hallelujah. Also, just before I get up to minister your word. Amen. You okay? Do you want to say something? David Block, who's coming, Professor David Block, is a Messianic Jew. But he is one of the world's renowned astronomers. And he's a real card. Amen. He's a real... Yeah, David is different. And being from South Africa, and he's now in the mathematics chair for Wits University. And he's highly sought after. He's here in Canberra writing a book, and we got to know him from South Africa, and one of our people asked if we'd like to have him. The reason I wanted him to come is that he has a tremendous slide presentation about creation, about the stars. It truly, from an intellectual perspective, he is brilliant, absolutely brilliant. We've had him at Rhema in South Africa and many other churches. And I just encourage you, like Sean did, to come and enjoy that presentation next week. It will be a little bit longer. I think it takes about hour and a quarter. But we'll flow with whatever the Spirit of God wants. But I just wanted to prepare you for that. So we don't want to shortchange him. He's flying up from Canberra just for us, and then going to fly back on Monday. So I'd encourage you for that. Amen. So now, are you ready for the word? Yes. Hallelujah. Just want to ask you a question. I know we've got a lot of visitors and there's a lot of new people. Do you all have this at home, which is the prophetic word for 2016? Do you all have it? Does anybody not have it? Just raise your hands if you don't. The ushers have got some cards to give out. There's some on the left and right. Maybe somebody can help Margaret give them out. Reason I wanted to do that is that one of the elements, I spoke on faith last week, and I want to speak on faith this week to continue, from where we were. And a part of this I'll get to later, but it says, about two-thirds of the way down, it says, the enemy will no longer be able to hold back that which my faithful ones have stood in faith for. The things that you and I have stood for are going to come to pass this year. Hallelujah. Amen. I don't know. It's the devil. Diane's going, why is your nose? I have no idea why it did that. But we know. Someone says, because I cry a lot. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to share your word about faith this morning, about where we're going to be standing, and what we stand upon is your word, the word of faith. We give you praise for it, Lord. Anoint me to preach and to teach and to be the instrument, the vessel that you wish to bring across truth to your people, Lord. And we give you praise in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Dr. Savelle told us before Christmas, I want you to study faith, one of his books, because he believes that the enemy is trying to move people of God, particularly JSMI, Jerry Savelle Ministries partners, and Heritage of Faith churches, away from our foundation of faith. And that's not going to happen. Because we are Heritage of Faith. We are, our magazine is called Adventures in Faith that JSMI produces. And so what I wanted to do is to understand why we're going to stand on faith, and then to explain from Daniel about how the Lord will help us walk in faith this year. He's empowering, challenging us to read the Word, to get into the Word, in order that we may be able to stand in faith. Because Heritage Church is a loving family doing life together through faith and prayer. Faith is a foundational element of our life, and it has to be, each one of us. Because we're told the just shall live by faith. That is the just, that's you and I, we have the source of our life in faith. And last week, let me just recap a couple of things. Paul in Romans 1 says that he has become a bondservant of the Lord Jesus Christ. Diane and I have been taken captive, as the word says, of the Lord Jesus Christ, but also been taken captive of the mission and the vision of this church, which is making winners. A number of people said to me a while ago, not in this last week, that you know what, you can't make winners, they're born. Well, the medical profession and psychologists actually disagree with that. They say winners, or as Dr. I looked at Dr. Charles Garfield says, it says winners are not born, they are made. Amen? And he uses this phrase, he said, that you are not truly free until you've been made captive by your supreme vision or purpose in life. Our supreme purpose in life is to assist you, and you are to assist others to become peak performers, to become winners in the game of life. That's what our mission statement is about, making winners. Doesn't matter what anybody else says. We can take hold of you, and through the Word of God, we will see you begin to change and grow and increase in the things of God. Amen? I do believe that. So, purpose. I looked about God's purpose last week, didn't I? And I said, now, out of all the assets you can have, money, education, networking, I believe the greatest asset that you can have is God's purpose. When we know where God's purpose is taking us, we have the why. And then out of the why, we will develop the strength in order to fulfill and complete our task which God has got for us. Each one of you here is not here by accident. Each one of you here has a task to fulfill in God, and for God, and through God, and with God. And whatever that purpose is, we will see some of that today, maybe. Amen. Diane and I and family have been away for a number of days, and I was sitting on the veranda yesterday, the day before, and I suddenly realized the privilege it is to see one person's life fulfilled. And because I've been taken captive by my vision, I don't care how many thousands other churches get made, how much money other people have got. I am commissioned and captured by my vision to see you make and be winners. When we hear the good reports that come in, and one of those good reports is somehow or other, John has decided to go horse riding. There is a multiplication coming. There is some of you are here for the first time. I love horse riding, and John loves bike riding, but I'm told he's come over to the light side, to horses, amen. But I want you to go to Proverbs 29. Maybe he's picking up on his destiny, his vision, his dream. Proverbs 29. The reason I'm saying this is not being fun, but a vision and dream, Proverbs 29, verse 18. And the King James says this. Sorry, 29, verse 18. It says, where there is no vision, the people perish, but he that keepeth the law, happy is he. The reason I want to bring it up again, that there is no age limit, no age restriction in that verse. No matter your age, whether you're a youngster just coming into the Lord, or whether you have older years, you're in later years. And last week, and I want to go over it again, there's no such thing as retiring in the body of Christ. Okay, there's refiring, retreading, whatever you want to call it. And I know it sounds a little bit cliche, but I want to take it beyond that. A couple of years ago, we were in Germany, and I was thinking about how I was enjoying being on holiday with my family before we came back to Australia. And I thought, wouldn't it be good if I could do this when I retire? And the Lord really slapped me. And he said, no, I don't want you to I want to hear the words retirement come out of your mouth. I said, well, you're not going to retire. Okay, well, then I'll keep going. I came back 2 years and told the church, we're not retiring. I'm getting younger. Everything is working. Amen. But again, last week, we began to talk about it because we do not have retirees in this church. And you know why we don't do that? Is because once you start declaring that you're a retiree, your body decides to listen to the word and start to shut itself down. You know, statistically, they tell us whether this is right or not. I wouldn't know. But within 2 years of the world, people in the world saying, you know what, I'm retiring soon, and their body starts to get ready. Within 2 years of retiring, they're dead because they have no purpose. Each one of you has a purpose. And I was thinking about it, and I managed to talk to Jim and Lynn before I came to the service because I really felt this. There are some of you here that may have more time on your hands than others because of the age you are and what you do normally. I want to encourage you to refire and to find purpose. I want to encourage you that it may be what? It may be going to visit an old folks home. It may be visiting. And I like Jim and Jan. I love it. They go feeding scheme. What is it? Meals on Wheels. There is so much we can do. And that's why Jim brought out there are umpteen places you can go volunteer. And if you don't know how, but there's something in your heart like, well, how do I get involved with Endeavor? How do I get involved with the Salvation Army? How do I get involved with Meals on Wheels? I want to be able to come in here knowing there's not one of our older members that does not have purpose and does not have vision. And if you do not know, well, I'd like to do that, but I wonder how. Go and speak to Jim and Lynn. I've spoken to them about it. They will do all the computer investigation. They will do whatever you need to help you find out where you can fulfill your vision and dream. I guarantee each one of you will be able to do something that will bless somebody's life. Is that okay? And so we don't have purposeless people, because there was something this psychologist said. He said, a purposeless life is an early death. A purposeless life is an early death. That's not going to be so with his. You will live long and see the coming of the Lord. Amen. And we have to declare that. Declare this is where we're going, because Philippians 4:13 says that we can do through all things through Christ who strengthens us. Is that right? You want me quiet? I'm not forcing you to do anything. I'm not going to check up on you. But I really would encourage you that there is something that we can do. There is something that the community needs you to do. We're in here. This is awesome. But there is something that you need to do. Now, you may not be called to Thailand. And our girls have just come back from Thailand, thoroughly enjoyed it. But there'll be something there. There is somebody on the other side of your miracle. There is somebody on the other side of your getting up tomorrow morning. There is somebody you can bless, whether it's that lady in the shopping center or the supermarket who's had a really hard day, and you can love on her. Amen. We used to have one lady in South Africa who decided she was going to phone one person every day out of the phone book. Just open the phone book, phone someone. Who was it? It was somebody. It was one of friends. I thought, really? Oh, and he did. And the marvelous time she had. DJ spends her time, and we've known her for a number of years now. She spends her time with people that are on the streets, down on their luck, and loving them and telling them of the love of Jesus. Be surprised how many people here are already doing stuff. Amen. Now, that was the introduction just for where we were last week. Now, I want you to go to Daniel. Daniel chapter 1. Because we want to go back and look at, last week I talked about faith. This is faith number 2. And last week we looked at, in Daniel 1, from verses 1 to 7, we looked at the 3 things that the devil tries to do in order to pull us away from the Lord and from our faith, to destroy our faith, in fact. In verse 4, the first thing he did, Nebuchadnezzar actually took the best, the cream of the crop, what he thought was the king's children, the prince's children, and he said, and the last line says, and whom they might teach the learning and tongue of the Chaldeans. The first thing Satan tries to do is indoctrinate you against the word of God. He wants to indoctrinate you that which is culture is right and we're wrong. Not true. We're not going to allow him to continue to do that. But he did that with the Daniel, Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. In verse 7, this is what he did. He changed the name of Daniel, Meshach, and Abednego. He changed their names. He tried to steal their identity. But he lost out, because you go back to verse 19 in that chapter 1, and King is actually calling them by their Jewish names.
He tried to change their name. Can you imagine if you keep calling somebody else another name? And we have a principle that the enemy knew about is when God changed Abram to Abraham, the father of many nations. But with that, he tries to steal their identity. It didn't work, and it certainly would not work for us. And then the third one is in verse 5. What he did is he fed their flesh. He gave them wine to drink and nourished them for 3 years. In the end, they might stand before the king. He fed their flesh. That's exactly what the enemy tries to do with us. There, it was a physical thing. It was food. And you may think it was a minor thing, but it wasn't in the light of Jewish culture. So what the enemy tries to do with us, he tries to feed our flesh for food, for lust for money, for comfort, for the nice chairs we got and the air conditioning we got. It's a comfortable area that we're in, amen? But he tries to deal us away like we saw in Matthew chapter 13. Don't have to go there. When it says the lust of the flesh and the desire for other things draw us away from God. Still the same today. Now, so what is he trying to do? There's three primary schemes. You probably think of plenty more others yourself, but there were just three that I got from this passage of Scripture. He wants to indoctrinate our minds, steal our identity, and feed our flesh. Is that okay? We're not going to do it. Right down in chapter 8, the first couple of words is where we're going to start again for this week. But Daniel purposed. Ever say purposed? Purposed. Or resolved or determined. It's a Hebrew word, which is quite a strong word, which means zoom. It's pronounced zoom. S-O-O-M. In Hebrew, it's S-U-W-M. And it's translated resolved or purposed or determined. It is not. It's the type of decision that you make that you don't turn away from. He purposed in his heart. He decided that this is where he's going to stand. It was not a New Year's resolution. How many knows New Year's resolutions average about 2 weeks? Don't put your hand up if you've broken yours already, but that's fine. I didn't make them because it's not worth it, you know. But it's usually about 2 weeks. And Daniel resolved not to defile himself. And my first encouragement today is you have to decide. You're going to decide that whatever I'm going to do with these three subjects that Ian's talking about, I'm going to make a decision because my obedience is better than sacrifice. Let's be obedient to it. So what did Daniel do? He knew God's word, and God enables us to stand firm in faith by knowing the truth. Faith cometh by hearing, and by hearing, not by having heard. Amen? And so we're continually hearing the word of God. And because we know that, it is also the converse is true, that it is impossible to stand in faith when we don't know the truth. We know the truth. Daniel knew the truth, so he was able to stand firm on the foundation of the word. Amen? We need to know the word. It's not rocket science. We need to know the word in order to stand firm. And I don't know whether I gave you guys the scripture when I put it. John chapter 17. I'll take it slowly so you can pick it up. John chapter 17. The reason I want to show you this is because you're in the world, but you're not of it. Now, the world will have a go too about that, but you are in the world, but you're not of it. John 17. Let me start at verse 14 in the Amplified. John 17, verse 14. I have given and delivered them to them, your word, your message. And the world has hated them because they are not of the world, do not belong to the world, just as I am not of the world. I do not ask that you will take them out of this world, but that you will keep them and protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, worldly, belonging to the world, just as I am not of the world. We as Christians, as children of God, have got to live our lives in the world, but not of the world. Is that okay? The word is clear about that, because we need to stand strong and not be swayed, if you like, by the teachings or some of the things that we hear in the world. Now, again, some of you may have lots of things, but I just wrote a small list because in the world, they seem to have an attitude that is right or reasonable. They'll tell you things which are right or reasonable, okay? The first one is that, oh, it's only a white lie.
Everybody heard that? A white lie, don't matter what color it is a lie. My wife often says to me, not about lying, but when she says it's a 60 limit, and I said, but I'm about 63. What's the limit? 60. So if you're over 63, they now catch you and they fine you. Why? You can't tell them, I was just a little bit over. That's like with lying. The world thinks it's all right to tell a lie if you're helping somebody. Don't do it. How about this one? And this affected me. Why I wrote it down. You know what we must do with our children nowadays? We must teach them to drink sensibly. My dad started to teach me to drink at the age of 10. Take me to the pub with my mum, and by the age of my 30s, I'm an alcoholic. Now, that doesn't happen to everybody. Some have a chemical imbalance. I didn't have that. I just drank a lot. But when I was playing rugby, I could handle it. When I was doing a lot of sport, I could handle it. As soon as I stopped playing that sport, couldn't handle it. You cannot. The world, it sounds reasonable, doesn't it? Teach them to drink when they're young, because then they won't get, no, rubbish. They won't. Now what we've got is a lot of binge drinkers in Queensland. How about this one? As long as two people love each other, sex is outside marriage is okay. No, it's not. Sex outside marriage is fornication. Sex outside marriage will get you into trouble. Just because the world thinks it's a game now doesn't mean to say we have to agree with it. I know this is going down very well. I'm sure you're agreeing with me there. How about, just one more. Let me just get through this one more. I just wrote these down off the top of my head. You know what we do? And this really gets to me. We should teach our 8-year-olds about safe sex. Oh yeah, we should teach them about safe sex because then we will stop the spread of AIDS. No, you should teach them about abstinence. Then it will stop the spread of AIDS. Okay, now, I'm going to get better, honestly. But I went down that road because, you know what, people speak to me and they say, but Pastor, you don't preach against sin. I said, no. Why would I preach against sin? Yeah, but you've got to stop it. No. I believe that if we preach God's word of his goodness and his grace and his love and his care, we will draw people to Jesus. And because they love Jesus, Jesus then will affect their hearts and move them away from sin. Have you ever found anybody who gets saved because, you know what, if you don't turn, you're going to turn into hell and you're going to burn. You may scare somebody into heaven for 2 minutes, but they won't stay there. You can't pick out people's faults in our lives and whatever you, and expect them to be drawn into the kingdom of God. We've got to show them the kingdom of God. We've got to show them the love of God. Amen. We'll get to that then. Anyway, I thought those four things would help you a little bit, but I've been accused of not preaching sin. I don't want to preach sin. Go to Colossians chapter 2. But Paul tells us what is happening. Now, you've got to understand, when Paul wrote this, it was a couple of thousand years ago. Colossians chapter 2, verse 8 in the Amplified. See to it that no one carries you off as spoil or makes you yourselves captive by his so-called philosophy and intellectualism and vain deceit, idle fancies, plain nonsense, following human tradition, men's ideas of the material rather than spiritual world, just crude notions following the rudimentary and elementary teachings of the universe and disregarding the teachings of Christ the Messiah. 2,000 years ago, Paul had the same problem. We have to be so careful that we do not allow ourselves to go that way. And by thinking things are okay because they're okay because the world does it. No, God's truth enables us to stand firm. Now, the reason I want to get through that is I want to give you so much of a positive. I found a new proverb, if you like. I don't know where I found it, but it relates to the Word of God. It says this, that which is false troubles the heart, but truth brings joyous tranquility. Let me read it again. That which is false troubles the heart, but truth brings joyous tranquility. Let me give you an example. I'll give you a couple. First one is that if you make a decision about something and you think about it, and down on the inside of you, you become a little bit uncomfortable. You may want to take a step back and stop. And go, and I've had people deal with this. They go stop and then they go, oh, I don't know whether I should go forward with that. And then tranquility comes or peace comes. It's what I would call knowing in your knower. Okay? Down in here where the Spirit of God resides, in your spirit, the sons of God are led by the Spirit of God. If I teach you the Word of God by the Spirit of God, then your spirit will grow strong and you will recognize and be led by your spirit that you will recognize that which is false. Amen? So when these teachings of the world come along and they say, well, it sounds very, very nice. Very nice to do this. But on the inside, you'll go, no, that's false. It's the same thing when you are listening to a CD, a tape, or a TV evangelist. If you're listening to him, you need to listen with your spirit. You need to listen with your knower. Okay, down in here. You need to know that when I'm sitting and I'm listening to any guest speaker, and any guest speaker that we have here will be word of faith and will love you and will build you up. Okay? But I've been in places where I've sat in a congregation and something has been said and my spirit immediately goes, that's not right. I don't know. I'm not judging the person. But when we judge what's going on against the character of the Lord Jesus Christ and his personality and the Word of God, you will know in your knower if I do my job right. Is that okay? And so why do we have the scripture? Why do we encourage you to bring your Bibles? Why do we have it going on the overheads? Why do we speak the word continually? And you probably get more word than most churches ever. Okay? Because I'm giving you scripture and verse that you can read. Why? I am feeding your spirit, not tickling your ears. Truthfully, I believe that we can do that. Truthfully, I believe the word of God will set you free. Truthfully, you can take that wherever you go. So if we do not know God's word, we open ourselves up to fine-sounding arguments and being taken captive by hollow and deceptive philosophies. You'll never be able to stand strong without the word. Is that okay? So there are other things that you will know that are wrong in your life that maybe you need to change now. That's all. Just look down in your knower. Why don't you do that for a minute? Just close your eyes for a second. No one looking around. Just look down into your spirit, look downwards and say, Lord, is there anything I've made a decision on or anything that I'm doing that doesn't create tranquility in my life right now? And if there is something, maybe you need to write it down, maybe you need to put it in your phone, and then maybe you need to go away with your Lord and speak to him about it. I guarantee time taken now will save you a whole lot more time in the future and of hurt. Take your time. Amen. Okay, second thing, moving right along. God enables us, because we know the truth, but God enables us to stand firm by remembering our identity. Remember with Daniel, they tried to change their identity. The world does the same thing with us today. It tries to change us into a mold of religion. It tries to turn us away from what we are, particularly when we make mistakes. And I brought that up last week. We make mistakes and we get accused of things. But God is encouraging us this week to remember. Psalm 103 says, remember, forget not all his benefits, who forgiveth all thine iniquities and healeth all thy diseases. Forget not. Do you remember when there was Joshua and Caleb? And Joshua and Caleb, they were chatting. I think it's in Numbers or Chronicles. I didn't look it up this morning. And Caleb turned to Joshua and he said, you know what? I've been here for 45 years and I'm as strong now for going in and coming out as I was then. Give me my mountain. I'm like, give me my mountain. And so when you look at that, you need to go back two or three verses earlier. They've been in the desert for 40 years. But he said, in a couple of verses earlier, he said, remember what Moses, the man of God, said to you and I in Kadesh Barnea about our future. Can you remember, for 40 years, they remembered what was going on. They remembered there were only two left. They were the ones that were remembering it. That is, over the age of 20. They were the only ones over the age of 20. And that's why it's so important with this thing. This is not something for you to put on your fridge and forget about it. This can be brought to pass. There is a future and there is a hope in Him. This is from our apostle. I believe it, don't I study it. Our pastors believe it. Our leadership believe in what he's saying. So I'm encouraging you to get hold of it, to get hold of what He is doing for you. Amen. I believe it sincerely that we can go forward understanding that we are children of the Most High God. Go to John 1, verse 12. John chapter 1, verse 12. I'm reading from the Amplified. But to many as did receive and welcome Him, He gave them the authority, the power, the privilege, the right to become the children of God. That is, to those who believe, adhere to, trust, and rely on His name. When you accepted Christ, that was it. You became His child. You became part of the family. You need to remember who you are. You need to remember who you are. Come on. Who you are is not what you are in the flesh. Who you are is what you are in the spirit. You are a child of the Most High God who can fulfill all things. You are crowned with many crowns. He crowned you in Psalm 8. He made you a little lower than Elohim himself. He made you a little lower than just himself. That's who you are. Now the world does, and I mentioned last week, they'll come along and say, you're some sort of Christian. Did it to us. But let me encourage you. It gets less. The longer you walk this road, the longer you walk uprightly, the less you will begin to hear those words, because the devil comes in your ear when it first happens. People come to your flesh, but gradually both begin to change because we don't put ourselves in a position where they're able to say it. And it's not a work of the flesh. It's an act of the Spirit. It's a strengthening of the Spirit that we can do what God wants us to do. Amen. When we have... 2 Corinthians 5:17. It talks about that we are new creatures in Christ. Old things have passed away. All things have become new. All right? We at Rhema got hammered over that 33 years ago. Hammered and hammered and hammered in a good way that we were not to forget it. We're a new creature in Christ. Old things have passed away. And if you continue to look at that, you will get to a place where you understand that all the old habits have gone. Paul said nothing good resides in this flesh in Romans. Our job is to build you by the Spirit, so the Spirit that raised Christ Jesus from the dead shall quicken your mortal flesh, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. And it gets less and less and less and less and less. Okay? Diane, when somebody cuts me up on the road, okay? And that happens occasionally. My wife, because I'm not always as genteel as I am here. Genteel. And I don't swear now. Praise God. It's gone. But I may say something facetious, something sarcastic. And she'll sit beside me and she'll go, lost your reward then, didn't you? And then, you know, you see that kid, and she does, it's just like I can see her swaying. Lost your reward, didn't you? Oh, that was love, wasn't it? Oh, yes, dear. Aren't you the pastor? Yes, dear, I am. I'm the pastor. But what I'm saying to you is those times get less and less and less. Until now, I'm planning ahead, because if you drive the same route, you know where people come in and don't slow down before that happens. Grace, you're my brother. Grace, my sister. This works, man. Tranquility is mine. Come on, you're all looking at me like you never do it. Come on. Amen. So what? God enables us to remain faithful by knowing the truth of His word and by remembering who we are. Lastly, there's a couple of things more. Verse 9 in Daniel 1. He says this, I never saw this till yesterday. Now God brought Daniel into favor, and look at these words in King James, and tender love with the prince of the eunuchs. Now you may think that it's not a sexual thing. It's not what he's talking about. The tender love he's talking about, you can never love people until you love God. We know through the writings of Daniel that he loved God with all his heart. What was it that was flowing through Daniel that allowed him to love his enemies? and for them to love him. Because in verse 10, if you put that up there, right at the bottom of that verse, the eunuch says, I fear the king. And you know what? I'm putting my neck on the line. This is my version. I'm going to put my neck on the line for you. Why did he do that? He loved Daniel more than he feared the king. Look what love does. That's Corinthians 13. Love never fails. And when I began to look at that, I said, yeah, Satan seeks to destroy our faith by feeding our flesh. But God enables us to stand strong in faith, walking in love and feeding our spirit. When we as a church and when we as a people walk in a love beyond anything else, then we will begin to see the benefits, the blessings of God in the way people look at us. I really believe that we can counteract that fleshly stuff by walking in love and in walking out of faith. Because you see, Daniel had to walk out his faith then. Because he persuaded the eunuch that, hey, listen, if you allow me to do this, I will be fine. And the eunuch said, okay, I'll trust you. And after 10 days, what happened? The veggies were doing their job, not the wine and the meat. So he was able to carry you forward. So Daniel used his faith. But how is he going to use his faith for something that he heard from God if he didn't learn love the God who gave it to him? Because isn't food just a minor thing? Well, in the Jewish culture, it wasn't. But also in our culture, we must understand, you do not commit adultery when you jump into bed with that other man or that other woman. You commit adultery months ahead up here. It's the little things, the little look, the little actions, the little things, the little lie, the little compromise. If you start, and you know you all love me, go on quiet again. I'm not saying that for any other reason except that it's the little foxes that will come against you. It was the little thing. Oh, is that okay? It's like the speed limit. If the speed limit's 60 and I go 65, am I breaking the law? Yes. It's not that it's running. You ask Jasmine as a solicitor. The law says 2 plus 2 equals 4, not 2 plus 2 equals 4.0001. You broke the law, slack. Pay the penalty. My wife's smiling at me, aren't you, darling? And now, what I want to say this to you, when you're talking, we're talking about walking in faith, and this is where I want to head off into a little bit. In Galatians 5, verse 6, if you'll put it up there, it says, faith worketh by love. I do not believe personally that we have faith failures. I believe we have love failures. We fail in the love walk. Why? Because let me give you Ian Slack's amplified version of Galatians 5, 6. That word worketh means this. It means activated to make capable of action. It means energized to cause to have energy. It means expressed to show or reveal. It means efficient, producing effectively with the least use of effort. It is effectual, successful in producing an intended result. It is powerful, having great power, force, potential, or effect, and extremely effective, efficient in action. Your faith this morning, when we walk in love and walk in the Spirit and feed our spirit, we are going to accomplish much that the enemy would hate. Amen? Because he's saying Satan is seeking to destroy our faith by indoctrinating our minds. God enables us to stand strong in our faith by knowing the truth. Satan is seeking to destroy our faith by stealing our identity. God enables us to stand strong in faith by remembering our identity. Satan is seeking to destroy our faith by feeding our flesh. But God enables us to stand strong in faith, walking in love and feeding our spirit. And I want you to go to one more scripture, 1 John 5. 1 John 5, verse 18. And the reason for this is that Jesus said in John, he said, keep them in this world. He said, don't let the enemy touch them. And then in 1 John 5, it gets repeated. He said, for whatsoever, what did I say, verse 18. First, 1 John 5, verse 18. 1 John 5, verse 18, that's right. We know that whoever is born of God sinneth not, but that he is begotten of God keepeth himself, and the wicked one touches him not. When we begin to walk, as I believe now, in faith through love, I believe the enemy will try and come and do whatever he wants. And we're walking and we're covered in that love, the love of God that never fails. And you may say, but Ian, you don't realize who I work with or the business I'm in. If I walk in love, they're going to walk all over me. No. They may think that they can, but the strongest thing in this universe is the love of God. The strongest thing that never fails. The love of God never, ever fails. Gives up, runs over, runs out. It never does. And so when we're looking to look at faith and we look at those definitions, your faith will go to the next level when you understand that your love walk is going to go to the next level and you will speak and it will happen. The ears will open, the eyes will open. The lame must begin to walk. But somehow I'm going, Lord, how does this happen? He said, what's your love walk? What's your love walk? What's your love walk? And that's all to do with the faith that we need to be able to walk in. Amen? We need faith to see what is going to happen in this coming year for you all. We need faith to know where we're going. But first of all, we need every single person that walks in this place, including you here now, to understand that God loves them. And we will never, and let's say, unless God really does something, preach against anything. I don't preach against any other body. Any person, we have to preach the love of God, the goodness and the grace of God, and you will fall in love with God so much that your staff, the people around you, they will desire to have what you have. Why do they want to be around Jesus? Can I have the worship team to come? Why did they want to be around Jesus? Because of his love, the love walk, the care. No matter what business you're in, no matter what you're doing, when some of you start this week to think about, come up, because that's fine. Start to think about helping others outside. I'm visiting somebody. Whoever your ministry is. When you walk in love, you will never fail. You will not. 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 Amen. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, what do you want us to do? Hallelujah. I do believe as we're going to ask people if they know Christ. You can't walk in love until you do know him. But then I also felt as well that there is a possibility in a crowd this size. And as you know, as the church grows as it is, we really want you to stretch out your hand of love and of care and blessing to our guests. But just maybe you're here this morning and maybe you've battled with that love walk. Let me ask you this. What do you think is the greatest hindrance to our love walk? Unforgiveness, bitterness, hurt. The reason I say that, not only that I believe it's scriptural, but about 28 years ago, because I'm getting old now, I can remember these old stories. At Rhema Bible Church, we had built a new children's ministry building that was about the size of this whole building of ours here. And we had, 1,250 children over two services on a Sunday, and Diane and I looked after 250 teachers. And all these children, and we believed it in, and the church had believed it in, and it was paid for cash, and it was a phenomenal building with five classes for the babies, big classes for everybody else. It was phenomenal. And then the Bible school comes along. And the Bible school at that time were growing, and they didn't have their own building. And so as they were growing and bringing finance in, because the children's ministry didn't bring finance in, they went to Pastor Ray and they said, you know, we really need to have this building. And so they started to finagle my building. It was my building for my children. And so they decided, they started to make some alterations. And over a period of time, I began to truly dislike my pastor. I began to truly get upset with him, because you know what? We've waited for years for this building, and now we're having to share it with Bible school students. So I was the healing. I was mad, man. I really was. Anyway, we're sitting in a service. Pastor's preaching, getting towards the service, and the Lord speaks to me. And he says, I want you to tell Pastor Ray that you love him. I don't think I'm going to listen to you. But I knew it was the Lord. And I said, you want me to tell him I love him? No, I don't want to tell him I love him. I don't even like him at the moment. He said, I want you to tell him that you love him. And I said, oh, Lord, no. And I battled toward the end of the service. And then I said to him, Lord, because Pastor Ray used to go out the back off the stage and what have you, never come down the front unless he was praying for people. And I said, Lord, I tell you what I do. I negotiated. I said, Lord, if you bring him to me, because you know what's in my heart, if you bring him to me, I'm going to stand myself. If you bring him to me, lick him in. She'll be fine. It'll be great. And I knew his habit was to go straight off the pulpit. So I'm sitting there with my eyes closed. I don't want to open my eyes. So I'm standing there. Okay, I open my eyes. And goodness me, he's standing there. And he's just standing and he's looking around. And I said, Lord. Okay, so I tapped him on the shoulder. And you've got to know, my pastor, Pastor Ray, is an ex-bodybuilder. He was a man's man. He wasn't soft to gentle and snivelly like me, eh? So I said, Pastor Ray, he says, yeah. And what? I said, Pastor Ray, I just want to tell you, I love you and I appreciate you so much. And just, that's all. I just want to tell you I love you. And he looked at me like you're looking at me and went, okay. And he walked off. That was it. But you see what I understood? If I hadn't dealt with that bitterness and the unforgiveness, I could have walked away from there and maybe never been here. Because it starts as a little root. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to ask, is there anybody here or by live stream that doesn't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? The second thing we're going to do is we're going to stand and I'm going to lead you in prayer. I think right now. Please go ahead and stand. And then if you've battled with unforgiveness or bitterness about something or someone, or that you've been somewhere and someone hasn't been nice, I don't want the little, you know, it's not the big things that hurt. Who knows if you get a grain of sand in your shoe, is that right? And you walk on it, boy, that thing can get under your skin, and it's a grain of sand. And I pray that we can take out by the Spirit of God today that grain of sand that is in your life or could be in your life. I'm not saying it is. If there's a grain, then we'll pray. But then if you need prayer, we can come down, we can pray for you. Because you may say, Ian, I have tried to forgive this person. I have tried to forgive this situation and I can't. But you can come and release it at the altar rail into the hands of God and let it fly away in Jesus' name. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, if you're here this morning and you do not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and you're watching by live stream and you don't, and I've got Christians praying in the Spirit, please. I want you to go ahead, just raise your hand and you just say, Ian, listen, I need Jesus Christ to become my Lord, my Savior, my King. If you're watching by live stream, we give you the same opportunity because it is so. That's all you have to do. That is the simplicity. Christ has already paid the price that you can walk into His presence right now with the acceptance and saying, Jesus, come into my life. Is there anybody here that would raise a hand and say, Ian, I need Jesus in my life this morning? Is there anybody at all? Don't listen to your head. Wonderful. I see that hand. Thank you, Lord. See that hand. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you for those two people, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Why don't you go ahead? We've got two people who are going to pray that prayer with us, and we know who they are, so Tony will grab them afterwards and be wonderful. Why don't you go ahead and say this with me? Say, Father God, In the name of Jesus, I come to you now, rejoicing that your arms are open wide. Thank you, Jesus, that I run into your arms and I make you now my Lord, my Savior, and my Master. Lead me, guide me into all truth. Thank you, Jesus. I love you, Lord. Bless you. Thank you for being my King. Amen. Father, right now I pray for those that are here. And that, Lord, if there be something that is as tiny as a grain of sand that is causing discomfort to them, I ask, Lord, as I pray and have them pray with me, that they will release a person, a situation, that will release whatever is needed to see them walk free, so they can walk captivated by you and not a situation, captivated by their purpose and their vision, not by the enemy. Lord, I thank you. I thank you. I thank you for it. Would you say this after me if you wish? Say, Father God, in the name of Jesus, I declare that situation that I remember right now, I release into the arms of Jesus the ever-loving grace and mercy of Him. Jesus, wash me clean. I release that person. I release that situation. And I replace it with the love of God. Fill me, Lord, with the love of God. Allow me, Lord, to walk free to those people. I will bless and not curse. I will give and not hold back. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I declare my freedom right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you right now as we end this service and we're going to just worship you a little. Lord, we open up the altar rail. And if there's anyone, any situation that they would need prayer for, Lord, I ask that you would use us as pastors, as ministers of your grace, to stand with them, to see them hand away that situation once and for all. Let it go, Lord. So it goes to you. You take it, for you can take our burdens. Carry our yokes, Lord. And we give you praise for it. We thank you now. And everyone said, amen. We're going to worship the Lord. So if there's
anybody... Hey, everybody. It's been a great service. I want to thank you for joining us. I'd like to take this time to say thanks once again. Maybe you'd want to become a part of that family of the Lord Jesus Christ, our family. Not about joining a church, it's about joining a family that goes beyond all sorts of boundaries and barriers. You need to be able to say that simple prayer with us. If you'd like to follow me, you say, Jesus, come into my life. Take hold of me, lead me, guide me. Father, thank you for sending Jesus to take my place on the cross and in hell, and so that I may live a life that is pleasing unto you. Thank you, Father, for sending Jesus. Holy Spirit, come in and empower me to live a life that will be pleasing to God. I want to thank you for saying that prayer and joining our family. We'd love to be in contact with you. If you would respond to the details on the website via email or phone, we'd love to be able to send some resources to you. God bless you.